Yeah, I got what? Ooh, it's kind of close.
I don't need my wife to bring.
Is it possible that the past and future are colliding?
Here we go.
Rated M for mature.
It's E3, our biggest show of the year. We've got over 20 games, world premiere trailers, Gears 5, and a major announcement about
welcome to Inside Xbox.
It's breathtaking. Inside Xbox starts right now.
Let's see what they have on this show. I can see a tentpole on this, just to be like it.
Inside the Microsoft Theater here in Los Angeles, California, for our biggest show of the year.
That's right, it's E3!
Yeah, yes.
The entire video game ministry is converged on downtown LA to reveal what's in store for the next year and beyond.
Yeah, it's amazing. And yesterday on this stage, right back here, we had 60 games, a new console, Xbox Game Pass Ultimate, and so much more.
On today's show, we've got world premiere trailers and the biggest games of E3. Gears 5, Watch Dogs Legion, Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order, and so much more.
Plus, one of the most popular PC games of all time is being rebuilt for Xbox. We'll talk with the developers of Crossfire X.
Looking forward to that. All right, then we're going to talk Psychonauts 2
yeah.
with the newest member of Xbox Game Studios, Tim Schafer.
Well, he was so funny on stage yesterday. It was great. And later, we're going to dive into the future of backward compatibility and reveal our biggest batch of titles yet. You don't want to miss it.
Yesterday's Xbox briefing was full of surprises and some incredible trailers. So what was everyone's favorite moment?
That was the internet's favorite moment. Yeah. I think,
you're breathtaking.
Everybody's breathtaking.
We're all breathtaking. Brilliant.
Well, I'm going to have to say, I'm going to go with the breathtaking Scarlett announcement we had, our brand new console.
Yep.
I have details on that in the future. And the Elite controller, Series 2.
Loves the hardware.
Besides
Keanu and having the fans lose their minds.
What else was so beautiful, Tina?
Well, Flight Sim. Bringing back that franchise
was
so great to see. You say nothing. Just fly through the sky. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful. So super excited we're bringing that back.
So relaxing.
Yeah. No.
I think I'm just going to have to go on the opposite end of the spectrum and say Blair Witch.
Yeah.
Because when it first started playing, I thought, it's Alan Wake, because it was like a torch. It's my see a torch. I'm like,
that's a flashlight.
Right.
For those of you here.
All right, let's not get
light
into
it. It's a light.
Yeah, it's a light. And then I saw like the cabin and then the footage and I was like, it's got to be Blair Witch.
Yeah.
And then the bit with the, it's the bit in the corner at the end of the film.
Oh,
I love the fact that it's so long after the movie, so they've had like 20 years
long time to
make
get it right.
Good.
20 years of nightmares with that guy in the corner of the cabin for me. For me, I love two things. I mean, there's a few more than
Forza.
That. Two things I really love, Rod Ferguson and Pyro. So when Rod came out to introduce Escape for Gears 5 and all the Pyro went off and the stage was revealed, that was incredible for me. And we also got to see our first glimpse of the Escape game mode for Gears 5.
Oh, Gears looks so good.
Insane.
Yeah. So
that
good.
Was grand. So let's get things started, shall we? Speaking of Gears as I was, let's send over to Jeff. Who's with the Coalition's Rod Ferguson.
Rod!
Thanks, everyone. We are here in the depths of the Hive. He's got a little something.
Oh, jeez. Okay, sorry.
This is an environment that is part of the brand new game mode that you announced yesterday called Escape. Can you give us the rundown on what this mode's like?
Sure, yeah, you know, Escape is really about you infiltrate the Hive, and you plant a poison bomb, and then you try to escape with your life.
And, like, this is quite a bit different than the other modes that we've seen throughout the history of Gears.
Yeah, it's a three-player co-op mode. It's aggressive, and that really changes things. Usually Gears, you think taking cover, holding back, waiting for the enemy to come to you, and this is really about pushing through. You got that venom bomb, you got that poison chasing you out. You have to get to daylight. The only way through is through the monsters, so it's basically pushing forward.
And you've got to make some tough decisions because you cannot just hunker down there. You've got to be aggressive. And that's something that I think different characters and different characters we've seen can play into that in different ways. Can you tell us about who we'll be playing with in Escape?
Oh, sure. So there's three members of your squad. We have the Hive Busters, which we call them. There's Mac, Lonnie, and Keegan. And each of them, what's different about this is not just about, you know, about what weapons you have. Each character has an innate ability, an innate and ultimate ability. So Keegan, he's our support character. He's able to put down a resupply and give ammo to his teammates. Mac is our tank. He's able to put up a barrier, eat a bunch of damage. And then Lonnie, she's the one out in the front, she's got an electro blade, and she can go and just press the attack. And so it's about how you coordinate together as a team and how you make those ultimate abilities overlap to make your way through the Hive.
And these folks have fully fleshed out stories as well in the comics, correct?
Yeah, we wanted Escape to have its own sort of, we wanted to do world building around it and create the characters that, like if you saw a screenshot with Kate and JD and Dell, you go like, oh, it's just, they take the campaign, goes into the Hive. Mm-hmm. And so this, we really want to be like, oh, this stands on its own. And once we created this identity with these Hive Busters, we really wanted to go deep on it. So we met up with Curtis Wiebe, who did the Rat Queens, also our Rom Rises comic book, and so now we have a comic book story going into the backstories.
So let's talk about replayability. You're not just going to escape once and you're done with it. You all are making a creative mode that's going to give tremendous replayability. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so the Hives are all built on tiles, and so one of the things when we started building these Hives and clicking them together, we realized, you know, we're doing it. The fans can do it, the players can do it. So we actually have a map builder that'll ship with the game and they can make their own challenges for their friends and put it out there. They have to build it, they have to beat it first. You can't just build the hardest thing possible.
Sliders all the way to the right, yeah.
So you build your own Hive and then once you've played it and prove it can be beaten and then you can put it out there for your friends or just for yourself.
So this summer, it's all about Gears 5. Now we're seeing Escape here at E3. That's just one of the pillars of a pretty expansive offering on Gears 5. Tell us about the rest of the summer and what we're gonna see.
Oh yeah, there's lots. And what's great too, for the first time ever, we brought E3 to the Microsoft store. So there's a bunch of select Microsoft stores where they can play Escape right now. So it's super exciting about that. But yeah, all summer long, we want to talk about Escape now. But in July, we're talking about Versus and we're doing our tech test where you get to go and play for the first time our multiplayer and play our new mode called Arcade. And then in July at Gamescom, we're going deep into Horde and talk about character abilities and how they affect Horde. And then in September, we're going right back to the campaign and we're going to revisit Cade and her story.
And Gears Pop as well, we saw a little bit about that.
Yeah, so kidding around with Ron. Our little trailer. Yeah, so when we said pre-order soon, we meant really soon. You can pre-order now. So I've already done it. You should do it too.
It very much is the summer of Gears. So Gears 5 set to launch September 10th. It'll be everywhere. Retail stores, Xbox Game Pass for console, Xbox Game Pass for PC, Steam, and if you can, if you're in as a Game Pass Ultimate member, you get it early.
Right.
So there's in addition to that, a special bonus that caught a lot of people off guard yesterday. Tell us about it.
Yeah, it's super exciting. So if you pre-order the game or you play the first week in Game Pass, then you'll get our Terminator character pack, Terminator Dark Fate character pack. So you'll get the T-800 and you get Sarah Connor, which is super exciting because Sarah Connor is so iconic. And she really represented the story that Kate goes through from some of the civilian to warrior. And this is what Kate's doing in the game. And so we felt it was a perfect match.
When we saw that metal foot come down on the skull, I was like, no, no, no. All right, one last thing before you go. You announced a partnership with E-League for Gears 5 multiplayer recently. What's on the horizon?
Oh, yeah, so that premieres this Friday. And so basically, we're following six different players and their journey into competitive gaming with Gears of War. And then that's going to culminate into a tournament where we get to see those six players and their teams compete. And so, yeah, there's going to be 6 weeks of episodes. And that's what I love about our esports content. It's more than just, like, watching gameplay footage. It's really about who these players are, who the community is, who the fans are. And you really get to go deep on who, like, and really cheer for them. And
sorry, I was catching up on any other news I'd missed.
Personalities.
Well, it's like the Olympics. You know, when you want, you don't, you know, name for me, like, a triathlete. You can't. But when you have those biographies before the event, you really care, right? Mm. And that's what this is. You get to understand who the players are, and then you get to watch them compete. And that means more.
All right. And that's this Friday as it begins. In just a minute, Phil Spencer is coming by to talk about Project Scarlet, xCloud, Game Pass Ultimate, all of the big announcements. But first, check out this trailer for Gears 5 competitive multiplayer action. As we said, coming to E-League this Friday.
Since day one of me playing, I was never seen as the best player in the game.
I used to get bullied in school because I didn't know the language and I couldn't understand people.
My father will give me 20 pesos. I knew that with that 20 pesos, I will not have a lunch, just use that money for playing video games. Like, that's how much I like it.
I hope that when I'm done competing, I leave behind a legacy that I was a player that never gave up.
I 100% feel pressure to stay on top. Being at the top, you kind of have this feeling that everyone wants to take you down.
Before the pro circuit, I was basically a typical kid. Go to school, come home, play until my mom gets home, eat dinner, take a shower, and go to sleep.
I don't want to work a normal job. I don't want to work for someone. That's my goal in life, to make it somewhere in this game industry and hoping that Gears of War 5 blows up and I blow up with it.
A lot of people don't know what it takes to be a professional gamer.
The objective is to pretty much build a brotherhood.
I think it's a brotherhood, but it's a really fragile brotherhood.
You're never really guaranteed a spot.
I know I was getting dropped.
People would talk behind other people's backs.
I do not regret it. I just wish some things could have been different.
But I know deep down they know that I'm right.
You could wake up tomorrow and all of this is gone.
I can see Gears 5. Really excited for it.
Let's go and play it, all right?
Let's go.
I got one. Oh my
god. Nice shot. Did you see that?
We've been stuck in the old for a little bit now, and I think everybody's excited for the next chapter.
When you get bruised up, you get beat up, you get knocked down, when you go through roster changes, when you go through drama, when you go through failures, you got to stay focused and positive and keep going forward, because that's the only way to make it out.
Bonds and Betrayals of Brotherhood, Fridays on TBS. Interesting.
All right, yesterday's Xbox.
I just want to get to the backwards compatibility stuff.
Had 14 titles from Xbox Game Studios, over 60 games total, a surprise Keanu appearance, a new console, the return of Master Chief, and so much more as well. And here to walk us through that staggering list, it's head of Xbox Phil Spencer. How are you feeling, Phil?
Staggering Phil Spencer. Staggering Phil Spencer. Keanu was on our stage. How cool was that?
How did it feel to be upstaged by Keanu?
I was all good with that. No problem there. He was such a sport. I thought it was great talking to him before, and I told him that gamers, Xbox fans, it's going to be more passion than maybe you find coming out for like a movie or something else. And
yeah.
Talking to him afterwards, he was blown away, which is awesome.
He's a total dude. Now, someone else who's a total dude who was on stage is Tim Schafer. Talk to us about Tim and Double Fine Productions and what that
Double
means to
Fine.
Add them to Xbox Game Studios.
Yeah, you know, we've worked with Tim since back in the original Xbox days on the first Psychonauts. He did some great Xbox games through the years. As we're looking for great teams with a track
there's some backstory
really
to that one too.
Differentiated talent. We approached him.
They were Psychonauts 2 was supposed to be published by Starbreeze. Starbreeze had some
fraud or something. Announce where we are with Double Fine, and they'll be joining Xbox Game Studios. I thought Tim was fantastic on stage.
So
he is hilarious. If people haven't watched the videos that they put up. I'm really excited to just see with the kind of the financial stability that we can offer, the creative freedom that we can offer.
That's the big one, the financial stability.
They obviously have Psychonauts 2, and they're going to go finish that. But I think the future for them and us could be great.
Yeah, that Tim with the XL team as well. Can't wait to see what they've got there. But yesterday was a really big day for Xbox Game Pass as well. So we launched Xbox Game Pass Ultimate. Xbox Game Pass for PC entered the game as well. Yeah. What's it been like to watch that idea grow from just that, an idea, to something that is so powerful now?
Yeah, 2 years ago. Yeah, 2 years ago here, well, over at the Galen, but 2 years ago is where we announced that. We broke a record yesterday in terms of number of people signing up for Game Pass, which was just awesome. Nice.
Yeah, it broke every single one of their stores.
PC for the first time with over 100 games on PC, having Sarah come out and talk about Ultimate, you get Xbox Live Gold, you get Game Pass for console, Xbox Game Pass for PC. Seen a tremendous uptake in people signing up to that. But also 34 games on our stage that are premiering into Xbox Game Pass. Teams are really seeing the power of being in an at-scale subscription for their game launching and reaching as many players as possible. We're seeing some really great, I'm playing a lot of Outer Wilds right now, really fun game.
Yep.
But an awesome way to discover your next favorite game when you're a part of the subscription and so many games are coming in every month. It's really great.
Awesome, I'm delighted that Football Manager is in Game Pass for PC as well. That's gonna kick my addiction off again. Now, you also in the team.
We don't call it addiction.
No, okay, my love. My love. When you and the team also introduced the world to Project Scarlet yesterday as well, you talked about your commitment to compatibility. Can you tell us more about what that means?
You know, we stood on stage at E3 a few years ago and talked about Xbox 360 games coming to Xbox One. Then a couple years later, we talked about original Xbox games coming to Xbox One. So really, when I look at my Xbox One today, it's probably the most compatible console I've ever had. So we thought about our design for Project Scarlet. We definitely wanted to make sure that we were compatible across all the generations, not just with the games, but the accessories. Obviously, Xbox Live will continue, and you are who you are across the whole ecosystem, which creates, for us, it's really us respecting the purchases that our gamers have made on our platform. You know, some of these games people bought a decade ago in our digital ecosystem. You're going to turn on Project Scarlet and the entitlement's going to be there. You can go download the game and play. And as you know, gaming goes from really all physical to both a combination of physical and digital, I think us respecting the purchases that people have made at no charge, allowing them to be able to continue to play their games. And in many cases, those games play the best and look the best on the new generation, which frankly isn't easy to do. Is just something that I wanted to continue in Project Scarlet, and it's great to see us able to do that.
Okay, you also talked about Project xCloud and console streaming. Can you tell us a bit more about the difference between those two things?
Yeah, you know, when I think about where we're going, we're going to see games that were created for Xbox are being created for Xbox today, playable in many places. We're really focusing first on what it means to play these games on your phone. So when we thought about how can we get as many people playing on a phone as possible, Project xCloud is us putting Xboxes in our data centers and allowing people to access those. But we scratch our heads and say, wait a minute, we have tens of millions of people who already have an Xbox One at home. What if they could turn their local Xbox into their own version of xCloud so they can stream out of their home? So we have two things coming this October. We've got our data centers with the blades in there, with the Xboxes in our data centers, so you can access Xboxes that we have and able to play games from there. Or if you already have an Xbox One or you're buying one this holiday, you're going to be able to turn that into a server that you can access on your phone from wherever you go. That, no charge for that, and both of those things are launching this October.
Fantastic.
Or previewing. I'm going to be clear on this because, you know, we're here at our first public preview of xCloud now, and we're seeing people playing Xbox games on
just
their
right
phone
over there, right
over there.
Yep.
Getting tremendous reaction. But one of the things I've learned this generation is we should always be listening to what our customers want. You know, I'm not one that's going to tell them what they want or tell them what they should be doing. This is really about us putting options and choice in the hands of our customers and listening to the reaction that they have. So I love, we're spending a lot of time over there watching and listening to the thousands of gamers here that are going to get their hands on. And when we launch our preview in October, it'll be the same way. Like, I'm not claiming that everything, that we figured out every answer to every question, but I do know that me able to stay to my connected with my Xbox Live community and my games wherever I go is going to unlock more opportunity.
All right. Now, E3, we know it's a huge moment for video games, but we did another event last year, which personally I absolutely loved, XO18 down in Mexico City, an incredible experience.
It was awesome.
And I know it's a big deal to you, these XO events, right? Do you have, perhaps, any news for us about what we can expect from XO in the future?
Yeah, you know, I get sometimes accused I'm a little corny on some of the nostalgia around Xbox.
And when us and the team were thinking about last year and bringing back EXO, some of us remember we used to have EXO. And this EXO 18, as you said, Mexico City, was so special with the fans. Absolutely doing EXO 19. We're doing it this November. We're going to hold it in London.
Yes.
Which will be incredible. Hey. We have EXO 19 in London. I think it'll be great. We know we have such just a huge, passionate fan base in the UK. I used to live in London.
Right.
So I have friends there. So it'll be fun going back. We have three studios in the UK, too. So it's really interesting now to think about our local creators that are there. So I'm really looking forward to EXO 19 this November in London. I think we're going to have a great time.
That is amazing news. And you know I'm from the UK myself. Yes. So I know that the UK Xbox community are going to be absolutely over the moon about this. And can't wait to hear more about it and be out
there
for
Gamescom.
EXO.
I think we're going to give some more details.
Awesome.
And you know, make sure that everybody knows how to get signed up, knows how to get there. So
all right. So just to wrap up, Phil, personal highlight for you yesterday?
A little bit just for me. Yesterday, my two daughters were here at E3 for the first time. They used to, you know, they're watching on TV. I was able to get them here and come and see the show, see Dad on stage to them. I'm just Dad.
Yeah.
But, you know, when I think about the connection to the fans and the community that so many of us have, some of my really good friends are here, and I see them at FanFest every year. Mm-hmm. And being able to have my two daughters here, and that whole connection was great. Obviously, love the games, love everything that we're going to go do. But I think for me, E3 is as much about the business and the strategy and all of that as it is just as a community of creators and gamers coming together here in one place and really celebrating our love of this art form. And it was special to me to be able to have my family here with me.
Awesome.
Which was awesome.
That's a great story. Hey, congratulations on a great briefing. Thanks for stopping by and being with us, Phil. Really
Thank
appreciate
you.
It. Okay, in just a few minutes, we've got Ninja Theory coming to the stage with our brand new title, Bleeding Edge. But first, we've got to do something that is very E3. We're going to drop a world premiere exclusive trailer. So get ready for more Souls-like action, a new city to explore, and a ton of new gear to cut off your enemies and slap on your body. Woo. This is The Surge 2.
Okay. I really need to play the first one. We already talked about Gears 5. This is The Surge 2.
It's not over.
It sounds like Bleeding Edge will be next.
Chance to play the first Surge, you're in luck. It's available right now to download on Xbox Game Pass, along with other titles we just announced. Batman Arkham Knight, Metro Exodus, Hollow Knight, and Borderlands The Handsome Collection with the brand new DLC. So good. You can sign up for Xbox Game Pass Ultimate today and get access to over 100 games for your Xbox One. All the benefits of Xbox Live Gold, as well as the just announced Xbox Game Pass for PC. Right now, PC is in open beta, and once the full launch drops in August, you'll have over 100 games there too. It's kind of a ridiculous deal, you know, console, PC, gold, all together for just $14.99 a month, and the first month is only a dollar. So for a closer look at Xbox Game Pass for PC in action, I think I'm gonna send it over to Larry. Larry?
Thank you, Julie. I'm here with Jason Beaumont, and we've got the new Xbox app running right here. I don't know what this is. Is this a laptop or a desktop? I know it's a laptop. It's some monster Alienware. But we've got it running right here, and Xbox Game Pass on PC was no simple task. Tell me about how this came together.
Yeah, so we started by just talking to gamers. And one of the things that we heard from gamers is that they play on console.
Okay, so this is the Game Pass section.
And they were looking for something like Xbox Game Pass to come to PC as well. Mm-hmm. Once we heard that, we started building the product. And we worked with over 75 partners to bring their games into the subscription. These include people like Bethesda, Paradox, Deep Silver, yeah. Sega, Devolver Digital. And we built a lot of platform features for them, like Win32 support in the store, mods, anti-cheat, to make sure their great games looked great in our systems.
All right, so you've got the framework all set up, and the way you're going to discover and download all of these new games is through this new Xbox app, right?
That's correct. This is the new Xbox app, yep. Available yesterday.
Yesterday.
Launched yesterday into
maybe
beta.
Maybe even earlier.
Maybe even earlier. That's right. And it's available in the May 2019 version of
Now,
Windows.
This is the live version, so walk Absolutely. Me through, so anything that happen, but walk me through some of the tabs and show everyone how the app works.
Great. So we're on the Game Pass tab right now.
Yeah, we're signed in with my account.
That's right. And at the very top, you see kind of some of the games that we're highlighting, things like Imperator Rome, Metro, Hollow Knight, etc. And as you scroll down, you see different pivots on the Game Pass catalog.
Right.
One of the things that's cool about Game Pass is it really helps you discover some genres and new types of games that you may have never tried.
I mean, we heard Phil say it and Sarah say it, you can discover your next great game, right?
That's right. That's Yesterday. Absolutely right. And in fact, one thing I also like about it is if you have Game Pass and I have Game Pass, we have access to the same library of games from the subscription. So one game I love is Football Manager.
Right.
I get it every year. I love it. And I'm always trying to get my brother to play it with me.
Okay.
Now that he has Game Pass and I have Game Pass, he has no excuses.
Sure.
He can play it with me.
Exactly.
Right. So that's the Game Pass tab. It's really great for discovering the next game for me to play.
Yep.
The next tab is Social.
Right. Now, social is great because I can see you've got my chats. These are, and then we flip over to the friends list.
That's right. So
these are my real friends.
Those are your real friends.
And I think you're on here somewhere.
I am on here, actually. I see you playing all the time.
Yeah.
And in fact, you could even see some things like whether they're playing on console or whether they're playing on PC. This tab also works hand in hand with the Xbox Game Bar.
Okay.
The Game Bar can just be a WinGee. It is an overlay that can come over any Windows game.
Yep.
It has things like audio settings, performance, one-click broadcasting to Mixer, looking for group so you can find some people to play with, etc.
And it's really important to point out that I know some folks may have seen Game Bar before, but your team has done a lot of work over the past few months to completely revamp it. It's customizable. Check it out.
That's right. Absolutely. The final tab in the app is the store tab.
Of course.
Yeah, of course, right? Now, one thing you may notice here is that this has a lot more games than maybe you had seen before in the Microsoft Store on Windows.
Sure.
We wanted to make this tab really about the types of games that we think people who use our app would want to see. And so you see things like Forza games in here, a lot of the games that are in PC Game Pass are on here. If you're a member, you can get up to 20% off the games that are in the Game Pass catalog, the Xbox Game Pass catalog, and up to 10% off DLC.
I want to talk real quick. We've got a bunch to talk about here, but I want to, why we've got the Windows Store, I now have this other game store, but they're really looking at the same catalog. It's just a different pivot, and you've customized this for gamers.
That's exactly right. We wanted to create a view that was perfect for them. It's all about kind of tailoring the user experience for what those people want to see.
Now, what's going on over here on the left side?
So those are all the games that we have installed. And so we could take a look at some of them, things like Imperator Rome, The Surge, And like I mentioned,
there's your football
there's
manager.
There's my football manager. Yeah. And so you could play, or you could choose
to buy.
You
can actually expand them out a little bit, so you can, just in case you don't know what the icons are.
That's
right?
Exactly right. You can expand at the bottom down here.
There you
and
go.
Take a look at it as well.
See them all. Now, where and when can people get their hands on this new app?
So if you go to xboxgamepass.com,
yep.
It'll have information about how to download the app. It'll even have a handy installer if you're on an older version of Windows yep. and you need to upgrade. That'll yep. kind of shepherd you through the process and get you started with Game Pass, either via PC Game Pass or Ultimate.
We'd love to have you, and it's awesome stuff. Jason, awesome. Thank you for this walkthrough.
Thank you so much,
Xbox
Larry.
Game Pass is supported by some great developers, and we spoke to a few about what it means to them.
The job of Devolver really is to get those games that we work on out to the widest possible audience. We're a small company, so we're always looking for help.
When Microsoft first approached us to see whether we would want to be part of the program, we jumped at the chance.
The greatest benefit to the gamers with the Xbox Game Pass for PC is the ability to discover and try games.
If you want to play an FPS, they've got FPS games. You want to play Valkyria Chronicles, that's going to be in there.
Fallout, Elder Scrolls, Prey. It's a great way to bring our games to an audience that maybe hasn't had a chance to experience them.
We can't just be on one platform and expect everybody to go there, right? That's dumb. So I think this is part of that evolution.
I see it as the beginning of the democratization of gaming.
I'm really excited to see Wolfenstein 2, The New Colossus, coming to Game Pass for PC. It provides an awesome experience combining story and character and over-the-top action. Award-winning title that maybe not everybody's had a chance to play. Game Pass for PC is an awesome way to check it out.
One of the games that's coming to Game Pass first will be The Messenger. It is awesome.
If you've it looks like Ninja Gaiden.
Shinobi or you've heard of Shinobi, then you're in the right place. If you've got any interest in side-scrolling action, platform, beat-em-up games, this is...
Hey, Commander Keen, take some notes on that.
Football Manager is. It's a football management Ouch. Game that puts you in control of every decision that a football manager would make in real life. It's one of the most played single-player games on the planet.
We're bringing Imperator Rome to Xbox Game Pass for PC. It's a classical Paradox grand strategy game played on a huge map covering the Roman time period where you can play any country from Rome down to the smallest little tribe in northern Germany. Your goal is to create an empire.
I was told many, many years ago that the PC was a platform that was dying as a gaming choice. And I'm here to say that it's thriving and growing. Long may that continue.
You know and love Ninja Theory for their intense story-driven adventures.
More
like
on Ninja Tour, Ninja Theory's new game.
So their new game is something quite different.
Teenage Mutant
and here to
Ninja
tell us more
Theory.
Is creative director Rani Tucker. How you doing? Welcome to the show.
Thanks.
This is a lot less intense than being up there.
Yeah, that was pretty crazy.
Custom Jordan 11s?
So obviously Ninja Theory is known for kind of its Jesus. Single-player stories and stuff like that. So how did
somebody's being paid way too much money.
Yeah, I mean, I think Ninja Theory's always had some combat DNA, you know, like Kung Fu Chaos, Heavenly Sword, that's the game I saw that made me want to work there in the first place, and obviously with DMC. And it just felt like, to me, after DMC, to me when I made Hellblade, which is very story, character, experience focused, and that totally suits him, he's awesome at that. But for me personally, I'm way more interested in the combat, gameplay, the touch and feel, so that's the direction that I wanted to go in. And at home, I like to play kind of multiplayer competitive games. So it was just kind of the thing I like to play.
You know what game
this
looks
like?
This looks like the...
Brilliant. Fantastic. I mean, so talk a little bit about the setup. Is it kind
of
like
what was that game?
Like, what's kind of going on? Let's kind of pick
Came out at the same time as Overwatch.
So there's like heavies,
from 2K.
And support characters. And there's also a mix of ranged and melee classes as well. But some of them are kind of a little bit crossover. So El Bastardo, for example, is a heavy, but he can also do quite a lot of damage. And Kulev is a support, but he can also lean a little bit into damage. So you can kind of lean a little bit with.
It's not so exact.
Yeah, I mean every fighter is so unique anyway. But yeah, we kind of split them into like architectural classes, just so people can kind of get an idea what they're going to be doing.
No one wants to read a whole bunch of text at the start. Like, what does this guy do? Okay. So,
what is that game?
How does the kind of monster system work? So, yeah, how am I going to make my particular character, like Buttercup or something, different to everyone else's?
Yeah. So there's mods in the game. Each character comes equipped with three mods, And then as you play, you earn more mods, and then you can replace what's there by default with different stuff that
God
you unlock.
Damn it. What was so that the idea game?
Is you don't get more powerful, you just get more options, two. Like the more experience you get with the game. So for example, a character like Demon, his default kit comes with a little bit of extra health, I think extra damage on his katana and extra range on his shuriken, and that's kind of like a good all-round set. But say you wanted to go more into stealth and be all about stealth ninja, then you could take... exactly, right? So you could take, like, stealth never runs out, you could take extra speed while in stealth, and say extra damage coming out of stealth, and you could kind of gear him more towards that. So there's plenty there to choose from. You can kind of mix and match them, and you can think about how that synergizes with what the rest of your team is doing.
So that's my next question I was going to ask, was kind of like about the kind of synergies and sort of combos and stuff. Like, is there anything that we should be sort of particularly looking out for? Like, what works really well together? Come on. I mean, we want to get ahead of the game here, you know what I mean?
I mean, there's definitely some moves that combo quite well together, you know, like the Buttercup pulling a guy in, and then Maeve drops her cage on top and you've sort of locked a guy down, or you get Nidhogger and slide into the middle of a big team fight and drop a big ride the lightning super and it stuns everybody and it kind of people think and destroy everyone.
I mean, it's mad. It's complete. There you go.
I didn't know Octopath Traveler had come out to everything.
I think there was like every move in that one little shot there.
That's amazing.
Five new items in my inventory.
The upcoming technical test. What's going to be going on with that?
Clamp
steam. Well,
we're
going to start letting people in on the 27th of June. And then we're going to start with weekly tests and just, we're going to be just honing the game, seeing what people think, getting their feedback. And we're going to be adding more content, you know, checking all the technical stuff,
badges.
Make sure it's robust, and matchmaking is working right. And we'll expand it over time.
A to Z.
All sounds really good. It looks bonkers in the best possible way.
Well, thank you.
Thanks, Ronnie, so much for coming on and talking to us. I personally can't wait to get my hands on it. So in just a minute,
Battleborn. Yes, Battleborn.
Order will be on our stage. But
that
first,
game
the creator
alive.
Of the brutally difficult keyboard smashing of XCOM is back with an all-new tactical strategy game, Phoenix Point. It launches on September the 3rd and will be coming to Xbox Game Pass for console and PC. Here's a world premiere trailer.
Never even heard of it.
Who's next?
I'm next.
Go back to the 90s.
But I'm in LA and I still have not made the trip to Galaxy's Edge down at Disneyland to build a lightsaber. But I can hold out a little longer because we've got Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order on our very stage and our very special guest, Stig Asmussen, director at Respawn. Stig, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
What a great week you guys have had with this, with these trailers.
Yeah, it's been super exciting.
It has been unbelievable. Now, you had this huge gameplay reveal at EA Play, and I want to dig into that in just a moment. But could you first set the stage for us? Where are we in the Star Wars universe, and who are we playing as in terms of the timeline?
Yeah, so this takes place between Order 66 and Episode 4.
Right. Now, Order 66, for those of you that don't know,
It's the operation that the Emperor executed that, like, basically said, turned all the clones on the Jedi, and they were thousands of them.
I believe the line was, all of them. Yeah. Something like that.
Yeah. Anyway. So you play as Cal Kestis. He's a Padawan that actually escaped.
Yep.
And during this game, he's on the run. He's hiding early in the game. He gets outed, and he becomes branded as an enemy of the state. And the hunt is on.
Now, we were watching this. The gameplay looks fun, but everyone's asking, wait a minute, who's this new droid? What's that all about?
It's BD-1.
Okay, BD-1. What does he do?
He's Cal's companion.
Okay.
He's on the mission with him. He's what we would call an explorer's droid. So he's got a lot of missions, functions that really help Cal out when he's out in these, like, savage planets.
We can see here we've got a beautiful 3D map, tell you what's going on.
Yeah, that's Metroid-inspired. Okay. Our level design in the game is Metroidvania.
Oh, wow.
So we looked at the map from Metroid Prime very closely, and we're trying to kind of reverse engineer it in the Star Wars way.
Now, I want to talk about the philosophy for the combat in this game, and what do you do to make encounters, what do you want them to feel like?
Powerful.
Powerful.
But we also want it to be grounded. You are a Jedi. I think we're looking at the original trilogy the most for what we're trying to do.
Yeah.
But we want, like I said, we want it to be grounded. It is a video game, so he's going to do things that are more powerful than you'd see in the movies.
Sure.
But he might not seem as over the top as some of the other lightsaber Star Wars games we've seen in the past.
Now, we've seen a few abilities here. Tell me about just some of the abilities we'll be able to wield.
Well, he's just able to throw his lightsaber and return it like a boomerang.
This now, here's stopping time.
This is force slow.
Okay.
And here's force pull. We just went away from it. But
yeah.
he then is able to throw him back into the lightsaber bolt while it's still frozen in the air.
Now, when I was watching your EA Play stream, we kept getting skill points, but we never saw the skill tree. Tell me about the progression.
Behind closed doors, we're showing people the skill tree. Okay. We're going to release
skill
a video
tree.
In a couple days that has,
okay.
It's roughly 25 minutes long, so it has another 12 minutes of gameplay.
Sure.
And in there, I believe we go into that skill tree for, actually we don't. I don't want to
Okay, don't make any promises.
But yes, we have a traditional skill tree in the game that
sure.
allows you to upgrade your abilities as well as your force powers.
Of course. Now, as I grow in power, will I become an Order 66 murder machine? Or do I have to take each encounter, like, seriously?
You got to take the encounter seriously. Early in the game, when you don't have all your powers, there's still going to be a challenge.
Sure.
As you get more powerful, when you reach a verse, those original challenges might not seem so hard,
yeah.
but we're going to bring new challenges as you get deeper in the game that test you.
Now, Respawn and the entire team is known for creating incredible movements. We saw this in Titanfall.
Yep.
And so how does that work? What did you take from that to bring to the Jedi?
It's all about feel. Our game is very, it's very twitchy.
Mm-hmm.
There's no lag when you're using the controllers, and that's kind of a Respawn philosophy.
Right.
You just really feel connected to the player at all times.
I have to ask what it's like to work on a Star Wars game, because somebody who grew up with the original trilogy, and I've seen them all many times, and I'm a huge Star Wars fan, that's got to be really great. I assume you're a Star Wars fan.
Of course I am.
I mean,
huge Star Wars fan. It's influenced my entire career growing up. It's incredible. It's also super stressful. I mean, some days I feel like the weight of the world is on my shoulders, but coming to an event like this, seeing the excitement really makes it worth
but
it.
But I also know that working with folks like Lucasfilm and so forth, they give you kind of like parameters you can work between, right? In terms of your character development, what they can do, right? You have some creativity.
Yeah, it's more of a collaboration. We tell them, this is what we need to make a great game, and they work with us to find things in Star Wars that play within the rules that we're setting for gameplay.
Yeah. Totally different than movies, but it's a lot of fun. Anyway, Stig, thank you for coming by. Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order is set to launch on November 15th. You better get back to the studio. You got some dev work to do.
Yeah, we do.
All right, let's send it over to Graham, who is definitely in his element.
That's right. Thanks, Larry. Now, as a controller connoisseur, I was very excited about the Elite Series 2 announcement yesterday. It is great, and I've got one right here. The new grips, the redesigned sticks, and come on, you can charge it inside the case as well. It's incredible. Now, this hardware was a real passion project for the design team, so we went behind the scenes for a closer look.
My name is Elliot Su. I'm industrial designer at Microsoft Device Design Team, and I was the lead designer on the Xbox Wireless Controller Elite okay. Series 2.
This looks interesting. Okay, the charging dock
is
in
the case.
This is the
world's most advanced controller to date. This product has been a passion project for all of us here at Xbox, 4 years in the making.
Okay.
So we interview some of our most passionate gamers, as well as doing thousands and thousands of hours of play testing in order to understand what are the right features, what are the things that our most devoted fans respond to, and what are the things that they want from a controller. The Elite Series 2 has been completely re-engineered from the inside out with improvements to all mechanics, all functionality. Better bumper durability, better grip durability. One of the most critical features is the new adjustable tension thumbstick. What you can do here now is actually adjust your thumbstick back to the original 360 tension all the way up to the Xbox One current tension. Another feature is that we have a wraparound grip. So on the Elite One, we have it only on the lobes here. On this one, we've wrapped it completely around that allows people with different hand grips and playing styles to have.
I'm not sure how I feel about that.
Controller. On the original Elite, we had two hair trigger switch positions. We've now added a third one, which allows for a much shorter throw on faster response. We've added a digital profile switch here. On Elite One, there were two positions that allowed you to customize your profile. We've now allowed for three customization profiles. Those that are familiar with the Xbox One wireless controllers know that there's a battery door here. On our Elite Series 2, we've actually internalized the battery. Each charge can last up to 40 hours of continuous gameplay. Games can
I think that's not much of an improvement over the current one. I think I get like 25, 30.
Other hands. So we've taken our controller into our testing lab. Fixtures and machinery that allow us to, in a short amount of time, run through an entire lifetime of usage on our controller. They will do things like, they'll show you the mechanism that does the revolutions of the thumbstick and the button presses. And it just shows that, hey, we're testing for millions and millions of button presses. This, you know, constantly being pressed over a lifetime. Everything that goes into what'll make this controller last. The Elite Series 2 comes with the controller, as well as a carry case.
Same carry case, basically, except now it goes to a charging dock.
An area for all your components and kit. One of the innovations we did was that this charging puck can exist outside on the table, or you can charge the controller inside the case through the port on the back of the case. This product has been a passion project for myself and for everyone at Xbox. We are excited to release this to all our fans in holiday 2019. We hope you all enjoy it.
I pre-ordered it. I do have a scuff on its way sometime, a prestige, but it's always nice to have a backup.
How good is that? See all the amazing work that goes into a controller, as wonderful as this thing. Hands down, the best controller I have ever used. Now, the Xbox Elite Controller Series 2 is already available to pre-order in 25 countries, so go to xbox.com to reserve yours, and head over to the Xbox Twitter account, where you can have a chance to win one when it launches. So get over there right now, and you'll be in with a chance. Now, let's send it over to Julia, who's standing by with a new game that was announced only hours ago at Ubisoft's live event.
Yes, Watch Dogs Legion moves the series to a city I'm quite familiar with and has a wild gameplay mechanic I don't think I've seen before. There's no main playable character, and that's because every person you encounter is playable.
Wow.
Here to tell us more is lead producer Sean Crooks. So that's crazy for starters. Let's get on. Let's just say that right now. What's the story of kind of Watch the Legion? Like, how did? Well, first of all, tell us a bit about the story, but also tell us how this kind of no NPCs sort of thing came about.
So basically, if you look at the history of the Watch Dogs franchise, we always had the profiler.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, and always kind of looked into people's lives. But this time around, we said, what if that was real? Completely real. Everyone was simulated. You could follow them around. If they had a job, they would go there. And we explored that idea. It went to a crazy place, and it became something very ambitious, which is the fact that anyone in Ireland, you can play as all of them. Recruit them, train them, and then play them as a playable character.
Follow them around.
Follow them around.
If they go to work at a coffee place, I mean, it's probably like a less exciting thing that you could do in the game, but whatever. So, London, I'm excited that you're going there. Please, first of all, tell me that not everyone's Cockney.
Everyone is definitely not Cockney, don't worry.
Good.
We have a lot of diversity.
Okay, good. I was pleased. There's a lot of the time they do that, and everyone just sounds like they're from the East End or whatever. So what made you decide to come to the best city in the world?
The best city. Well, London is one of the most surveilled cities in the world too, right?
There is that, and
it's obviously strong for the Watch Dogs brand. It's a very diverse cultural city. And has some amazing architecture. The contrast between history and modern makes it an amazing playground for us to parkour to set a story like Watch Dogs Legion.
And obviously one of the core kind of things is this kind of hacking mechanic. Like, what's kind of new, what's fresh that's coming to the franchise in that department?
So in Watch Dogs Legion, we have a fully simulated drone ecosystem. You can fly on cargo drones throughout the city, get your parcels delivered by them. But there's also a bunch of combat drones, like the CT drones and riots that can help take you out. But you can also hack them and use them as tools to fight back also. And also we have multiple classes in Watch Dogs Legion. And one of the classes is the hacker. And the hacker can have this cool little toy called the Spiderbot. That can run around, sneak around, can deploy as a turret, has some less lethal rounds to take people out. It can also jump and electroshock people in the face. It's pretty cool.
I mean, I would do that. And there's a lot of people in London that like to do that too.
I'm sure.
Of course. So what was it kind of like? Because obviously you've just announced this. What does it kind of feel like now? Because one of the really difficult things with making a video game is you can't tell anyone anything for ages. It would drive me mad. So a bit of a relief?
A huge relief. I mean, the team is super excited. We're doing stuff that I don't think the industry has ever seen before. And the team were just thrilled. The guys, I'm very proud of all of them. Those guys are geniuses.
What's the thing you're most proud of that you can tell us about right now, you reckon?
That idea, we did it. We made it work. And you can play from, a kid from, central London, or you can play as a grandma. You can do everything in between. And realizing that, it's a big deal.
I reckon playing as a grandma's a really smart idea because it'd be the person everyone least expects to be up to mischief.
Yeah, exactly. She is incognito.
So when can we get our hands on the game? That's the most important thing. I know you've literally just announced it like 2 minutes ago, but
yes.
Like, when can I have it?
So Watch Dogs Legion is out on March 6, 2020.
So soon.
So soon.
So very
grandma
soon.
Grandma is coming very soon.
Hacking Grandma.
That's it.
Will be here soon. So Sean, thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you very
for
much for having
us.
Me.
Congratulations.
Thanks
and we look
a lot.
Forward to seeing more. So, and in other news from Britain, not going there, it was announced yesterday that Forza Horizon 4 and the world of LEGO are colliding very soon. Let's send it over to Graham, who's in front of a car that probably isn't street legal, although it should be. It might be easy to steal, but quite slowly.
That is a true work of art.
Yeah, thank you, Julia. Everything is awesome. This LEGO McLaren Senna is awesome. LEGO Speed Champions of Forza Horizon 4 are awesome. And I'm here with the awesome Mike Brown from Playground Games. Hey, Mike, how are you doing? He's here to walk us through this new expansion, which is set to launch this Thursday.
Yes, that's
we don't have
right.
to wait
this
long,
Thursday.
Do we?
Yeah, that's right.
That's awesome. So what can fans expect from this marriage, beautiful marriage, of Forza Horizon 4 and the LEGO brick?
So it really is this epic coming together of these two brands that people really love. And I guess
agree.
The story of it is that the Horizon Festival, with their seemingly infinite wealth, have struck this partnership with LEGO and decided to build a festival that celebrates all things LEGO, all things Horizon. So it's an entirely new map that players can travel to, and in there's loads of amazing things built of LEGO. So there's an entire city built of LEGO, there's a racetrack built of LEGO.
Love it.
There's a crashed UFO site, a dinosaur graveyard, Pirate's Cove, tons of other stuff that I'm forgetting. And all of that is wrapped up in like a brand new campaign as well, which gives players the maximum freedom ever to play the game the way they want to play. It really is a pack filled with content.
Mate, this is right up my street. But you talked about the campaign there. I want to ask about that. This is the LEGO Brick Challenges,
that's right?
Right?
Yes,
tell us
challenges.
How they work.
Yeah, so Brick Challenges are over 250 individual challenges that players can complete
what?
And progress in the game. Every time you complete a challenge, you earn some bricks. Some of them are really simple. It's just like, visit a certain area of the map or complete a certain race. Some of them are much more complicated, so it might say smash a load of sandcastles on the beach in a 1967 Corvette Stingray,
nice.
Or it'll have you careening from one side of the map to the other in a 80s Audi. So there's really great variety in there. You complete those, you earn bricks, and you use those bricks to expand your Lego house or build the Lego Speed Champions cars.
Love that. Now, you name checked a couple of cars in there, but we've got an amazing Lego car behind us. We've got to have some Lego cars in the expansion, right?
Of course we do. So this Thursday, there'll be three Lego Speed Champions cars in the pack.
Nice.
There's the Lego McLaren Senna, there's the Ferrari F40 Competizione, and there is the 1967 Mini Cooper S Rally. All of them, like, painstakingly recreated in incredible detail. As you zoom in, you can see the word Lego written on every brick.
Right.
When the light plays across them, the semi-translucent bricks, you can see the light coming through them. Even the subtle warping of the bricks can be made out, that little bit of warping from the manufacture process, that in just the right light you can make it out. So it's really incredible detail.
That's the thing I noticed when I played, just those tiny little details that you know and love from Lego, and you've brought them to life really amazingly. And I guess the reason for that is you worked super closely with Lego to bring this to life. Tell me about that process.
It's been an incredible partnership. Really, really has. From the very first moment we started to speak to Lego, it was just really obvious that we shared so many philosophies.
Right.
Loads of the philosophies they incorporate to make great Lego are the same philosophies that we incorporate to make great Forza games. And those same commitments to quality, the passion for the games and the products that they make. And that's just really shone through. They've been great to work with. On the team, quite a lot of us are big Lego fans, myself included. And I think that passion just really shines through there. Probably my favorite example of that is the map. In the map, ordinarily on our maps, we just take a top-down render of the game world, color in any bits that need coloring in,
right.
and then that becomes our map. I'm probably being a bit mean to the people whose job that is. But this time, Rich Evans, one of our graphic designers, he has built the entire map out of Lego bricks. So the entire map is built from Lego, over 180,000.
Has he really built it out of Lego?
He built it in the Lego Digital Designer, digitally
built
it.
That would be an achievement.
But it still involves like going into like a box on the computer, taking the brick, placing it. There's no like copy paste functionality. You still have to place every brick. And it's 180,000 pieces times four, because there's seasonal variants of it, of course. And to put that in perspective, a huge Lego set like the Death Star is about 4,000 pieces. So massive Lego Death Star, 4,000. Our map, 180,000. It's pretty crazy.
That
was his job for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks.
And I've seen the map myself, and I remember saying that it looks like the Lego world I wanted to build myself when I was like a young man. But just never had enough bricks.
You never had 180,000 bricks. Yeah, that was probably the problem.
Now you've worked on a sort of behind the scenes of your process.
Yeah. So a few weeks ago,
I just saw the note that they posted
To go to the home of Lego. We got a great behind the scenes tour of all the facilities they have there. I met all the Lego's best minds and really dug into their experiences and their philosophies and how they go about making great Lego products. It's a really, really cool set of videos. The first one, I believe, is coming out a little bit later on today during the Forza monthly stream. Tune into mixer.com/Forza later on to check that out. And then we have
actually done
today, bring up to the launch of the game on this Thursday.
Oh, excellent. 13. We'll be able to play it then. That's the day I get home from E3 as well, so I'm excited. Now, it's also important to note that you will be able to take the regular Forza cars that you know and love into the Lego map and race them around as well. And there's some really cool parts of the map that are really suited to some of those cars, is right. Can you tell us some of your favorites, like the racetrack or the stunt stadium?
The racetrack's amazing. I think the racetrack is something that people have been crying out for so long, and it's actually something that no Horizon game has ever had before. All of our races have taken place on effectively real roads.
Right.
So this is the first time we've done an actual racetrack with multiple circuit layouts and stuff, which I think our fans are gonna absolutely love.
Yeah.
My other favorite area is the desert, just because we never had anything like that in the UK map, because the UK doesn't have any deserts.
Right.
but now that we've embraced the fantasy of this a little bit, there's a desert, so you can get those buggies and stuff and go flying around the desert, which is just something you couldn't do in Horizon 4.
Oh, awesome. Right. I say this every year when we've got a beautiful car here. I think we should go for a joyride in it.
Let's do it.
I guess we can in this one, right?
Do you want to drive?
Yes, I would love to drive. We'll come right back to that. Thank you, Mike. I really appreciate it, mate. Right, the LEGO expansion to Forza Horizon 4 is available this Thursday. How good is that? And after the show, head over to mixer.com/Forza, just like Mike said, for a special episode of the Forza Monthly Series starting at 5 p.m. Pacific time. Hey, that's right after our show. It's like we plan these things, isn't it? Now, one thing...
fun doing on Inside Xbox is announcing when classic games become backward compatible. And today marks an incredible but bittersweet set of announcements with the final wave of games coming to Xbox One.
Damn it.
Let's take a look.
You think of gaming as both technology and art. Technology is all about being modern and new, and art can be timeless.
Last year, the team decided to tackle a feature that has been consistently at the top of your request list. And while we weren't sure it was possible, today, I'm pleased to announce Xbox One backward compatibility.
The passion of our community and our fan base is awesome. We're really committed to delighting our fans all over the world.
It was a very ambitious goal. We didn't know if everything was going to work.
We have to make the Xbox One operate just as if it was an Xbox 360.
The architecture is wildly different.
This is an Xbox One console. The same type of components, but it's much more powerful. It's faster, higher resolution.
The game itself doesn't know that it's actually running on a different piece of hardware. And it's better than you've ever seen before.
Better from a graphical standpoint, better from a frame rate standpoint, better from an input latency standpoint, just a better experience all up. Everyone in the team is just passionate about the product we're delivering.
They could do any job they want, but they choose to be here. I don't think I've ever seen people who love their jobs that much.
Look, if it was easy, everybody would be doing it.
True.
We've got over 600 titles in the backward compatibility catalog, but we're kind of moving on to a new part of the story.
We're heading into a new generation of Xbox, Scarlet.
The goal of the team is to make every single game that you play on Xbox One today work on the Scarlet device.
Ensuring every game that runs on Xbox One is going to run incredibly well on Scarlet takes a ton of commitment and time.
The team is dedicated. We are ramping up our test facilities so that we can hit the ground running and make sure that stuff works.
And these games are going with you to the next Xbox and the evolution of what that means.
With the Scarlet generation, we have significantly more power than we've ever had before.
We're all about making what you remember work with the things that you have today or tomorrow.
It's clear that the future of backward compatibility on Scarlet is very bright, but it just hit me. This is the last backward compatible announcement I'll get to make for Xbox One. I feel like I should, you know, pour one out, or how about we'll press F to pay respects on each one. You can do that from home. All right, here goes. I've got the last 8 original Xbox titles to announce, and they will start rolling out later this week. Okay, 2 from LucasArts, Armed and Dangerous, and Indiana Jones and the Emperor's Tomb. Also on the way, Sphinx and the Cursed Mummy. All right, you fans of Sam Fisher, we heard you loud and clear. You want the classics. So I'm super happy to announce all of the Xbox Splinter Cell games are backward compatible. The original classic, Pandora Tomorrow, and Chaos Theory. And as an added bonus, the original Xbox version of Double Agent, which I will remind you, it's not the same game as the 360 version. And finally, we are going to bring Unreal Championship 2, the Leandre Conflict, to backward compatibility. Now let's send it over to Larry for our last batch of 360 titles. Press F.
I'm pressing F, Jeffrey. All right, F as in 15 games, some of our most requested titles, and they just snuck in under the wire. All of these Xbox 360 titles will become backward compatibility this week. The planet smashing over the top.
No mech assault games.
Battlefield
That's
2
pathetic.
Modern Combat. From Software Strategy RPG, Enchanted Arms.
Okay.
The Ninja Theory Classic, Enslaved Odyssey to the West. Far Cry Classic and Far Cry Instincts Predator. The Square Enix RPG Infinite Undiscovery. That launch title we all played for the 1,000 gamer score, Peter Jackson's King Kong, the official game of the movie.
Like puzzles? How about Prince of Persia, The Forgotten Sands? Skate from EA. Star Ocean, The Last Hope. Super Puzzle Fighter 2 Turbo. The cult classic Syndicate reboot from Starbreeze. And here's one I bet you never thought would happen.
Too Human. Too
Human. And best of all, it's available for free. We're giving that one away. Finally, the last 360 title we're making backward compatible, Unreal Tournament 3, because you gotta have the whole series, right? All right, now let's send it over to Julia for our final announcement.
Question. Do you like games by Rare? If so, you're about to be very, very happy because 8 classic games from the studio are now enhanced for Xbox One X. This means that these titles will be in gloriously sexy 4K and the best that they've ever looked. So there's going to be Banjo-Kazooie, Banjo-Tooie, and Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts, all 3 console Banjo games. We've also got the Xbox 360 launch title Cameo Elements of Power, a Joanna Dark double feature, that's Perfect Dark and Perfect Dark Zero, and finally, both Viva Piñata games, the original and the sequel, Trouble in Paradise. All 8 of these Rare classics are enhanced for Xbox One X right now. The Backward Compatible program was a huge success thanks to the community and all of your feedback. The team is hard at work on the future with Project Scarlet. Since we just enhanced 8 Xbox games from old school Rare, let's check out what present day Rare is up to now. Sea of Thieves just celebrated their first anniversary with a major update, and the game just keeps on getting better and better with loads of new content, such as The Arena, Tall Tales, The Hunter's Call, and so much more.
I'm still kind of angry at the backwards compatibility. No Mecha Soul. I really need to play more Sea of Thieves.
Joining me now is CFE's executive producer, Joneet Joe. Welcome back to the show. Now, a little over a year ago, you launched, and it's been an amazing year, but the game keeps evolving, it keeps changing, and what has that been experience like?
Incredible. Like, it's been an amazing adventure for us as a team, as a studio, to kind of go on this journey with our players and growing and adding and just, you know, all of the different things we've added over the last year, and then culminating in the anniversary update, which has just kind of brought so much new to Sea of Thieves and has had such a great impact with our players in terms of just kind of numbers and sentiment and excitement. It's been amazing.
I mean, I know people that play this game because it's in Game Pass. If you have Game Pass, check it out. That just go into it and they're just smiling and they're having fun. You guys have just brought some of that whimsical, so much whimsy to it. The music, everything about it, it's just fun.
Yeah, I think that's Rare. That's Sea of Thieves.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's pure Rare, yeah, isn't it? It's like distilled down. Tell us about the future. What's going on?
So, well, you know, we're really here, like. You know, we've just had this massive update with Anniversary and all the kind of stuff that we've added. And so now you've got the Arena, you've got Adventure, which are kind of 2 parts of this game now. So, you know, for the last year, we've been growing the Adventure part of the world. But now that's had Tall Tales added to it. So we've now got this kind of method of delivering really cool crafted story and lore into it. And then we've got the Arena, which is now a platform for kind of competitive gaming in Sea of Thieves. And you know, that's really just the start. And we just did, actually, like a little bit earlier, we did our first kind of Mixer Invitational, like, which was a kind of 3-hour stream. My crew won, by the way, boom. But it was so good. Like, when you get that really high level of competition between really skilled crews, it is intense. It's really great to watch. So it's all about now how do we keep growing and how do we keep kind of building on what we've got there?
Right. Now, I have to say, I am a huge Sea of Thieves fan, yeah. And when our producer said, you're going to have this segment, I said, whoa, what are they talking about? They said, there's a surprise. You're bringing something for the community. We don't want to say what it is.
There is.
I have not even been told what your special gift is to the community.
Yeah. So
you at home, everyone's going to take a look, and we're going to see it together. Here we go.
I know, right? Like, so we partnered with the Halo team. They've been amazing to work with. Even that music there was Robin Beanland, Ivor Novello winning, Robin Beanland
right.
That did a kind of version of the Halo music himself in a Sea of Thieves style.
But, can I do one thing?
Yes.
Robin?
Yes.
I want that as a shanty. Okay, that's all I'm going to do. All
right,
go ahead.
Yeah, but they've been great to work with. They love the music.
Yeah, I'm
stuff.
Like, really upset about that.
That we kind of captured of it, but in our style. So that's going to be for anybody that now plays Sea of Thieves during the week of E3.
Right.
You will get that for free.
You just have to turn up, log in, play the game. Set sail for a little while, and you're going to get this. What did we see there? We saw the Spartan livery.
Yeah. So you've got the figurehead. You've got the sails. You've got the kind of flag and everything. So it's the whole kind of ship kind of cosmetic. So you'll get that whole set. And it's so special. It's celebrating an amazing kind of part of. You know, Xbox history and future, right, with Halo and what we saw yesterday. But it's done in our style. It fits into our world.
Yeah.
So it's so special. So,
am I going to see some Thief Thieves in Halo Infinite? Not an announcement. Not an announcement. I just want to be very clear. It's not an announcement.
Indeed.
Do you have anything else you want to share about Sea of Thieves?
Yeah. So,
congratulations.
You know, so with everything that we've added as part of anniversary, it's had a huge impact. And so we wanted to share a couple of numbers, actually, just around the success of Sea of Thieves.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
So far with Sea of Thieves, we've had like 8.4 million players so far have played Sea of Thieves.
Wow. Launch,
which is huge, right? It's a new IP, brand new, like all those players.
Congratulations.
Whether it's they bought the game or came by Game Pass, like, so amazing kind of numbers. And since anniversary launched, we've had over 2 million people played just since anniversary alone.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and it's kind of our third highest month, I think, in terms of like monthly active users since the launch kind of.
I'm not sure.
Huge momentum, huge excitement.
TLDR, people love the game.
Yeah, and it's never been a better time to come in and play Sea of Thieves, especially if you go and get the Halo cosmetics this week, right?
That is, congratulations. Next time you come on, I want to have a number for how many bananas have been eaten.
Yes, lots.
All right. Joe, thank you so much. Thanks for coming by. Now, remember to log in today through June 15th to get that special Halo gift absolutely free. All right. Age of Wonders Planetfall is a new 4X strategy game from Paradox Interactive and Triumph Studios, and it's set to launch on console and PC on August 6th. We've got an exclusive new trailer that introduces one of the game's factions for the first time. The Assembly. Basically, they saw the movie RoboCop just one too many times and took it for gospel. Check it out.
Triumph Studios and Paradox bring you the tactical, turn-based combat and in-depth empire-building game, Age of Wonders, Planetfall. At a distant planet, the next generation of bionic soldiers were being produced. But during the collapse of the Empire, facing extermination, a new race emerged, the Assembly. Now the Assembly looks at each world with one thought in mind, how to turn its inhabitants into organ donors for their growing empire. As units die, they can be brought back by the reverse engineers, while the scavenger infantry unit is armed with cybernetic claws that can rip out chunks of the enemies and reabsorb them into their own bodies. If you face the cyborg army of the Assembly, be prepared to blow it to bits or become a part of it, literally.
I guess I have to be the one to tell you. You're dead.
Oh!
You're obviously new to this whole existence, but truth is, most of you types won't even make it a whole year. We have one rule. You don't break the masquerade.
Huh.
Or is this vampire? I haven't really paid.
This city.
Oh, it's vampire.
We're all fighting over scraps here.
Welcome to the first day of the rest of your death. Having fun yet?
The Masquerade.
Three. Bloodlines. Two. Whatever.
Coming Q1, 2020.
After well over a decade, fans of the cult classic RPG Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines finally got what they wanted.
Blah, 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 blah.
A proper sequel is coming soon, and here to tell us more about it are Cara and Brian. So, obviously the first game was released in 2004, so kind of the uninitiated. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about it?
Well, when you're a vampire in Vampire the Masquerade, you have to keep the masquerade, which means that essentially when you're thirsty for blood, you have to kind of not let anyone
be cash.
See. Yeah,
just being like, cash.
If humanity finds out, then they might come and hunt you down. So the basis of that is basically you've got to be quite secret, walk the line a little bit.
Sneaky vampirism. Okay, yes. All right. So what kind of gameplay are we going to be seeing today? What have you got to show us?
Yeah, in the trailer we just showed, we're showing some footage from the first third of the game, and you're still kind of a thin blood, so you're still working your way up into the world, and thin blood is kind of a less powerful version of the normal vampires. And,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So, like, you're probably just going to phlebotomy clinics and siphoning off some blood there, taking a... No, I'm just
kidding. That's the easy road.
So how does your character evolve? So you talked about these different kind of stages just a little bit, but how does that work throughout the course of the game?
Eventually, you kind of develop a lot of like skills and powers that are to do with how you choose to play the game.
Okay.
For example, you might choose to, in disciplines, you might choose to basically... get like more and more in like say coercive behavior, like,
okay, like
coercive, like
persuasive
right. Negotiation tactics,
right.
Like
give me your blood, please.
Come on, Microsoft. This
yeah.
is all we need.
Yeah, and also stuff
it's
like
all we need.
You know, traditional skills, disciplines, such as like vampire magic, kind of.
I'll be one but, happy fumble.
You know, it's an RPG, so expect a huge progression system and choices that actually go off the.
I mean, seriously.
Sounds interesting. So you moved to Seattle for this. Like, how did that kind of come about, and how's that going to kind of influence the game? You were like, yeah, there's a load of bloodsuckers in Seattle.
Yeah,
what are you saying?
It's dark and rainy. It's depressing.
Yes.
Yeah, it's, I mean, you know, for 6 months, it's totally dark. So anyhow, no, you know, we're based in Seattle, so it's a lot easier to kind of go
out. Oh, that's quite useful. That makes
a lot
of sense.
To, like,
yeah,
go out and look.
I mean, I can't understand all the games that require licensing and all that stuff.
And really present stuff that we,
both of these games
like,
were
know about and then,
published
you know,
by Microsoft.
Put it in the game.
Both
kind
of them.
Like dark underbelly as well, because there's like a kind of historic.
Rights are still owned by Microsoft for digitally.
That, you know,
so
like
why no Microsoft?
Does that exist in Seattle? Did I miss that last time I was there?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, good. Good to know. So how did you kind of write like what it's like to be a vampire? How do you even go about doing that?
You just stay indoors in the dark and
I mean,
don't go
kind
outside.
Of what, that's what I do anyway. I feel like I should have helped.
And then you drink blood, obviously.
Less of that these
so
days,
you...
trying to, you know, keep that down, keep trim.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Some scheming.
Scheming, manipulating.
I do love some scheming and manipulating, though. That's good. I mean, it looks great, though. Look at this. Fantastic. What are we seeing here?
You're seeing a bit of the combat here, so yeah, you can use.
Let's see, no GTA Vice City Max Paint 3.
Yes,
okay. Forza Motorsports 1, 2, 3, 4. Mafia 1. Mafia 1, yes. I don't understand why that one.
Become vapor and go through vents, air vents.
Ooh, I've always wanted to become vapor.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's just always appealed to me.
No hit and run, I can't understand that. Anything licensed, I can't understand that.
Such a long period of time. Does it feel like a homecoming?
It actually, I mean, it was pretty natural just getting back into it. It was just like, well, the best thing about the setting is
I'm reading it what everybody was expecting. Lord of the Rings Conquest, licensed,
of
course. Nope.
Tons of stories you can write with the setting. I mean, it's
original Nier.
So we've got, you know, this story is set in Seattle, but it could be set anywhere.
Yeah, and we've got like a kind of modern Seattle to pull from. So, you know, there's a lot of like issues going on in the city to do with like old Seattle versus new Seattle that we kind of weave in there. So it's like a really nice concept.
No Jet Set Future. That,
cool.
I think there's licensed music
in
that.
Thank you so much to you guys. Thank you so much, Brian and Carl, for coming and joining with us and showing us a little bit of that. I mean, we never have enough time. There's so many games going on.
Buffy, the licensed.
Let's set it it back stubs, over to the stage. Zombie, one of the most popular PC games
Godzilla,
of all time.
Blah,
is
blah, blah.
Exclusively to Xbox.
So many people want licensed games.
Got all the details.
Smilegate. Oh, this is that. Puzzle Fighters. Skate. Hey, people got their skate announcement!
Joining me now, Sorobu and Jinwoo Young from Smilegate and Nico Beery from Microsoft Global Games Publishing. Gentlemen, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Larry.
Now, Mr. Boo,
Max Payne 1 through 3. Yeah, okay.
That is staggering. That's double the population of the United States. Tell us about Crossfire. I can't get my head around this game.
Crossfire는 지난 10년 동안 아시아에서 많은 사랑을 받아왔고요.
No time splitters.
개발사로서 콘솔 시장에 도전하는 것은 어떻게 보면 당연한 목표고 또 꿈이기도 했어요. 하지만 많은 준비가 필요하다고 생각을 했고 그 준비가 지금 현재 되어 있다고 저희는 판단을 했어요. 그러한 사실을 MS 엑스박스 팀과 같이 훌륭한 파트너와 함께 발표하게 돼서 기분이 되게 좋습니다.
Okay, over the past decade, Crossfire has achieved quite a lot. Even so, launching a game in Western.
I'm surprised King Kong got backwards compatibility, but you know what? I just purchased it for my 360 again, so I could actually finish it up.
To accomplish that, now we believe we are ready. And we wanted to announce this with our great partner, Microsoft Xbox.
Nico, this is the first time Crossfire is coming to consoles and Xbox, and I know we're working closely with Smilegate to make this happen. What does the partnership
Amped? Ooh, mean? That's incredibly
excited.
That's another Microsoft game.
Smilegate Entertainment. They've been working on this incredibly tight competitive multiplayer experience for over a decade. Like, it is massive. Yeah. And they're taking this experience that they know very well, and they're blowing it out with a ton of new content as they bring it over to the West in Crossfire X. We're excited that this deep partnership really gets us connected to the incredibly smart people within the Xbox organization that can help optimize and really get the best experience that we can to our Xbox players. Also, a huge amount of support.
I think people forget,
they're
asking for all the racing games and stuff like that, but unfortunately those are just too impossible to license.
Maps and game modes. Can you talk about what will make the jump to Xbox?
Crossfire X.
Mercenaries 2는
Unreal 4로 개발이 되고 있고요. 하이엔드 게임에 걸맞게 하이 테크놀로지들이 탑재될 예정이에요. 콘텐츠 구성은 크게 말씀드리면 기존 팬들이 사랑했던 콘텐츠들을 혁신적으로 업그레이드해서 탑재를 할 거고 또 콘솔 유저들이 콘솔 유저들에게 환영받을 수 있는 콘솔 전용 콘텐츠들도 많이 탑재할 예정이에요. 확실하게 말씀드릴 수 있는 건 크로스파이어 X는 전체적인 구성이 많은 선택지를 여러분들에게 제공을 할 거예요. 더 자세한 정보는 수개월 내에 인게임 정보를 여러분들에게 소개를 하겠습니다.
So we are developing a Crossfire X on Unreal Engine 4, which will be.
And I'm pretty sure none of those mechs in the two Microsoft games were unseen, because that had happened years prior. So,
all brand new contents that are specially designed for only
they actually had TROs in these things. I think they did.
We are very confident that will.
Wow!
Most amazing and
unused Xbox. I mean. Jesus.
So, let me add some more details about what I meant by that. So we
Xbox
have,
Live 2 month free fraud.
PvP mode that
the code is still there.
And
never been used.
Unique PvP mode, which leads you to more immersive gameplay than ever before. And on top of that, we have a single player campaign mode that you can play.
Let me see.
Actually,
it was the Owens,
about
the Hackman, which
Battle
was
Royal
a,
mode
they,
either. So
a lot of times they just recolored the
awesome,
mechs in this game.
Battle Royal mode, which is looking very unique and great fun to play in a way of Crossfire X. So as you can see
Stiletto,
now, we have
Raptor,
a lot of
Nova Cat,
contents to choose from. So in a few months' time, we are going to show you a bit more about our game. So that's. I think that's definitely something to look for.
Great, thank you very much. Now, Nico, obvious question, when will we get to see more of Crossfire X?
Look, it's just the beginning, Larry. I know people are super excited. We're going to have a ton more to share at
Blinks, Master of Time and Space.
More about game modes, as well as our unique content that we'll be offering our game.
I understand all the racing games, otherwise I would have asked for Project Gotham over.
All right, let's send it over to Tina Summerford, who's on the on the floor with Katie Jo Wright from the Gaming for Everyone team.
All right, I'm joined by Katie Jo, the lead for Gaming for Everyone. So I know you were watching the briefing yesterday in the stands, like all of us, losing your mind. And Phil called out Gaming for Everyone. What does that moment mean to you?
It was absolutely awesome. It was absolutely awesome. Because Gaming for Everyone is really about those 2 billion gamers that he also talked about. Is that whenever any of those
Xbox Live came November 2002.
So
I've been a member 17 years, 18 years.
On the device that they're on, or even finding the community that they're looking for.
Well, speaking of content, it was a ton of it. What are a couple of moments that resonated with you?
Some games from the original Xbox that I've never even heard of. The Unseen.
So awesome to see. But then
I've heard of that
one. My personal favorite was Gears of 5.
Quark.
Or Gears of War 5.
Yeah. Blinks, the first one. Kung Fu Chaos.
No longer
I can't
even
pronounce that.
She's the lead character,
NFL Fever.
So
NBA Inside Drive. Quantum Redshift. Wow.
And I can't wait to play it.
And I know we were talking a little bit about Hellblade, too. You had a chance to play that on Project X Cloud.
Yes, that was so awesome to be able to play that
game.
It felt exactly the way that I played it on console.
I know I'm ranting about this, but it's just kind of irking me.
And just that game in general is so awesome to me.
Okay,
mental
but
health,
the free
such a compelling and empowering
and
way.
The thing they free gave us was
outdid themselves with that
nailed
one.
It, nailed it.
Fucking
so
too human.
Outreach is happening here at E3. What is that?
That is torture.
Outreach is actually a nonprofit.
Anybody who has gone through
with,
the dying scene in to human
so
knows what I am talking about.
Proceeds that we raise goes to Gamers Outreach, which is an organization that puts gaming cards in children's hospitals across the U.S. And actually, I just learned yesterday they're in Canada now too.
Yeah.
So they're putting gaming carts in hospitals so that kids that are there for an extended stay can still have that sense of normalcy through play while they're really focusing on healing.
I love working with you on Gaming for Everyone. You do fantastic work. Where can people find out more?
So on Xbox.com/foreveryone, it's a new page that we just launched, but we'll really be sharing our stories about how we're making gaming more inclusive for all, accessible for all, and safer for all. And so we'll be updating with content updates that we have and services, and then also updates from our G4E communities.
And your last stop is not here. You're going to be on Mixer
tomorrow,
so tune in to Katie Jo on Mixer tomorrow.
Yes.
Back to the stage.
All right, see ya.
Here's ID. I'm trying to think of the term I'm trying to use. I'll just put it as war crimes. Oh. Yeah, Two Human was actually designed as a trilogy. I mean, I enjoyed the game.
Now, here's the guy that helps us get all of those games. Chris Charla from ID at Xbox is here. Welcome to the show, neighbor.
How's it going? Shout out to the 903. Yeah.
So tell me, we just saw a ton of games. Like, what has jumped out at you here during that huge montage and all of the ID presents?
Well, it's been awesome just seeing all those games. I mean, on that montage itself, I think like Totem Teller, Dead Static Drive, Blazing Chrome, like those kind of games, just like to me are just like, holy cow. But really all the games that we've shown at the show and other games besides games like Ooblets that are coming to Xbox are just, I have the best job in the world, and the ID at Xbox team is obviously not just me. Like, we get to go out and meet with tons and tons of developers all over the world, just look for super cool games, and then figure out how to get the world to know about them, whether it's bringing them on stage here at E3 or helping them get into Xbox Game Pass on Xbox and on PC, and it's just been a super fun experience.
And I think in the world of ID at Xbox and indie games, it's not just about the variety of types of gameplay, but I feel like year after year, the quality bar goes higher and higher. Like, if you're imagining, oh, this is what an indie game looks like, and then you see Blair Witch, which I gotta say, looks incredibly frightening.
Right.
It's continually impressive.
Yeah, it's amazing. Like, both the work that teams are doing and then the work that, you know, honestly, middleware providers are doing, like Game Maker and Unity and Unreal, like what a group of, you know, five or six dedicated men and women can do today that versus 5 years ago, 10 years ago, it's like ridiculous. So the quality bar just keeps going up, and then the innovation just from gameplay and crazy ideas also keeps going up. It's just an awesome time to be in games.
Talk about what it's like working with these groups. Some of them are bringing their first game ever to market on Xbox.
It's awesome. So, we get to work with pros. We get to work with, like, people who've been around or maybe left big studios and started things. That's always super fun. But what's really amazing is getting to work with people where it's their first game. Or, you know, and I get letters from developers and, you know, that say, you know, like, hey, I've never made a game before. I always wanted to be in games. And finally, you know, I decided to, like, take the plunge and I did it, and I worked, you know, like a year, and I finally shipped my game, and, you know, and it's just like getting to see that, like getting to kind of be part of the behind the scenes of that, like, of, you know, seeing people who have these great ideas, like put in all the hard work, and it takes a ton of hard work to ship a game, to actually get it there and get it over the line, and then, you know, see success, whether it's, you know, Cuphead, which is, you know, crazy, or, you know, Gun World, you know, there's just all different levels of success that people have, and it's like, so, I just sound like I'm bragging, so I apologize. But it's so, like, gratifying and just fulfilling to get to just be a small part of that. And I know I speak for the whole team when I say that. Like, it's just like we're all charged up to go to work every day.
So you're meeting these folks. You know these folks. But I think some of you, maybe you're not familiar with some of these developers. But the good thing is that we feature 21 games that if you're an Xbox Game Pass member, like, you're going to be able to play these. And these are coming to Xbox Game Pass for PC as well. Now, one of the titles we featured was the Lord of the Rings living card game from Asmodee. They've got some more stuff on the way, don't they?
Yeah, Asmodee. A lot of people don't know the name. But if you go to the, you know, the game store and look at all the boxes, you will know who they are. So they're doing a couple new games that they're going to be bringing to Xbox. One is Pandemic, based on the famous board game, and the other is Munchkin, which, if you're like a hardcore nerd, you definitely know Munchkin. And they've taken the Munchkin IP and done something different with it, and I think we are looking at Pandemic right now and Munchkin too. Like, just really, really cool looking, and trying to capture that same humor that the original, you know, card and board games have.
Chris, you're an excitable guy. I feel like you're in your element here.
Yeah.
But what has really been, like, what titles have really jumped out at you that you're just really excited to bring to the Xbox fans?
I mean, there's a ton. So I would say, like, some of the games we showed at the briefing, to me, just blew me away. Like, I have to say my favorite moment in the briefing, Keanu comes out, Cyberpunk,
huge.
Everything's going crazy, yeah. And like you're kind of sitting there, and I know everybody's wondering, like how do they follow this? Like, how do you follow Keanu Reeves talking about the release date for Cyberpunk, and like boom, Spiritfarer, you know, which is a new announce of an incredibly thoughtful, low-key, hand-animated, beautiful game from Thunder Lotus. And to me, like, I loved that moment in the briefing because I was super glad that everybody got to see Spiritfarer and experience it, but like that contrast shows the kind of diversity that we have on Xbox. And, you know, obviously, tons and tons of people Cyberpunk.
Sorry.
People want to see Spiritfarer. Spiritfarer is going to be in Game Pass on PC and on console, so like everyone's going to get a chance to experience it. And like, I just love that diversity. I love that we're in a game industry today in 2019 where we can have Cyberpunk followed by Spiritfarer, and people are going nuts for both of the games.
And I love that you love games, because you're bringing us a lot of great experiences. So thank you, Chris, for dropping by. I'll see you at the PTA meeting next week.
Yep.
Now, we've got more ID at Xbox titles to talk about, but for that, we've got to send it up to Graham in the balcony.
Meeting, that's fantastic stuff. All right, everybody, I'm here with Tim from Rebellion. Now, you just announced Zombie Army 4 Dead War. Congratulations on the name, first of all.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely amazing.
That's what it says on the tin.
Absolutely. And we're going to show you gameplay for the very first time. So, Tim, you can talk us through this. What's new in the sequel?
So, it's our follow-up to, as you guessed, Zombie Army Trilogy, which is a 1-4-player cooperative shooter set in World War II, an alternative version of World War II in which Hitler has raised the armies of the undead to, you know, fight against the Allies. And it's very much a kind of a tongue-in-cheek horror shooter, and it's a huge amount of fun. And we've got loads of new stuff in the sequel. We've got new melee combat. You can do sliding tackles to take out the enemies.
Nice.
We've got upgrade paths for all the weapons and for the characters as well, perks and skills and things. So there's a lot more depth than we had in before in terms of what you can do in the game. Loads of really cool things like new enhanced kill cams, slow-mo bullet cams, trap cams. There's nothing better than seeing like a group of zombies exploding in extreme slow motion.
Right, I've always said that.
You know, things like attachments that you can put on the weapons, so you've got like electrified rifles and shotguns and things.
Nice.
It's a lot of fun.
One of the things I've always loved about Zombie Army Trilogy is the co-op,
yeah,
play, right? Playing with other people.
Yeah.
Have you made any changes to that?
Well, we've pretty much enhanced every aspect of the game as far as we can. So fans of like Sniper Elite 4 will be familiar with the feel of the ballistics and the gunplay and things. And so there's loads more detail in the gameplay, and the ways you can take out the zombies together are hugely enhanced. One of the interesting new quirks we put in is like instead of having to wait for your buddies to heal you when you go down, which is obviously an established thing in co-op games, we've got one of the perks you can actually like revive yourself if you manage to just
sorry I've gone off about the mech assault thing, but that
it adds an extra little frisson of tension to the game.
And tell us about the state of the world in Dead War. Like, what are some of the environments we're going to see?
So we are set in and around Italy, southern Europe. We're venturing in other areas around the Mediterranean. So the footage you're seeing here is from the first level in the game, which is in Milan and the train station. And everything kind of kicks off again at this point. You may have seen a glimpse of our flamethrower heavy there. We've got a whole bunch of new enemies in the game, of which the flamethrower heavy is a particularly formidable one, and one of the big differences in the sequel is like not only do you have to take down these enemies, but when you finally do, you get to pick up their weapons as well and deal with them. So like a flamethrower, horde of zombies,
it's the perfect combination, let's be honest.
It's a happy moment.
All right, Tim, thank you so much for coming by and showing it.
My pleasure.
Let's send over to Jeff for another game that features some more very bitey foes.
All right, Graham, you know how it is with zombies. You think it's over, and then you turn around, and there's more, and can't be too safe. Okay, when we're talking State of Decay, Wonder Russell always joins us from Undead Labs. You're the developer of State of Decay, and yesterday you revealed a brand new expansion for the game with a really cool trailer. I would say it was the best one in the series, but the environment looks pretty familiar.
Absolutely. Heartland is our biggest expansion yet. It's an all-new story-driven adventure, and it is set in the iconic location of the original State of Decay. Trumbull Valley.
All right, so let's talk about this story stuff, because State of Decay 2 in the main game, there was a lot. You made your own story, is how I would say.
Absolutely, yeah, very sandbox.
But here, you've created a narrative, so talk about how that works.
Right, so it definitely is, at its core, it's narrative-driven with storylines that have branching paths. So players will start with one of two sets of surviving characters. You can play as Quincy. He's an ex-con who's now a member of the network.
I respect that he's still wearing the tie during the apocalypse.
Yeah, absolutely. He's got to look sharp.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And or you can play as Larice, who's the long-lost daughter of Mickey Wilkerson, who also features in Heartland, and she's accompanied by her aunt Fiona. So both starting survivors have about 8 hours of gameplay in their story arc, when it's in the gauntlet. And so altogether, players are going to have about 16 hours or more to immerse in Heartland.
And, you know, in true, you know, State of Decay fashion, they might not all survive. Your experience might be different than mine.
No, actions have consequences, permadeath is real, and the game will change a little bit based on what survivors live, die, and also, more importantly, who you recruit. So the NPCs in Heartland are really special. They're handcrafted, they're really important, and they come with new traits. You're going to want to get them to build the biggest base at Jurassic Junction in the whole franchise.
All right, so let's talk about Trumbull Valley. This isn't your father's Trumbull Valley. You didn't just drop this story into the existing Year One Survival
Edition map. This isn't Sasquatch's Trumbull Valley anymore.
Oh. All right, so tell us about what you've done to Trumbull Valley. 18 months has elapsed, and things are a lot different.
Yeah, so the apocalypse, you know, time is up.
Somebody's mentioned that with all these game services gained,
looks like it's overrun,
Ubisoft having their subscription, EA having theirs, Microsoft,
dangerous, it's disgusting,
that
it's
other platforms will get deplatformed. But as I point out, EA has actually gone the opposite direction, one of the few things that's been really customer friendly. And they added a whole bunch of their back catalog games to GOG.
All kinds of ways to get through it and survive the gauntlet at the end.
All right. Got me ready to play. How do I play it?
You can play now!
Like
so
now,
excited
now?
Today!
After the show, that is.
Let's just go over. We got 4 stations. Yeah, we're so excited to get to announce it right here at E3. Announce it with the trailer yesterday. It's included with Xbox Game Pass.
Very good.
Or $9.99 on Xbox One and Windows 10.
So you may already own it. And I think the best part is, if you haven't played the base game State of Decay 2, you can jump directly into this expansion, and, you know, it's a completely different game.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be very accessible for players new to the franchise. Story was like
a
massive request from our
community. Wow, this has gone on for 2 hours.
We're really happy with what we've accomplished with Heartland.
And I think they'll be happy that you're listening. Wonder, thank you so much for coming by.
Thanks for having me.
The Heartland expansion for State of Decay 2, as Wonder said, available right now. And right now, let's send it over to Julia and Larry for an important announcement about the future of gamertags.
Yesterday at the briefing, Phil Spencer talked about our mission to reach gamers all around the world and put the players front and center. Today we have news about an update to one thing that we all take pride in, our gamertags.
That's right, throughout the
never
year,
changed your mind. It's still Fubble.
To support more character scripts to represent over 200 languages, and the list will keep growing.
Your gamertag can be in your own language. So, say if you're German and you want an umlaut, I hope I'm saying that right, in your gamertag, that will now be possible.
But that... We're also changing the structure of gamertags based...
So it's going to be more like, whatchamacallit.
Yes, we know that all the good names are taken, and that is not going to be a problem anymore.
That's because we'll open up the floodgates and let you pick any name you like, up to 12 characters long. And if someone else has that gamertag, Xbox will auto-assign a 3 or 4-digit ID suffix, so everyone's going to know who's who.
That suffix will be present, but the focus is on the actual name. We'll be showing off the tag front and center.
If you had your eye on a cool gamertag that was taken, this will be your chance to grab it. We'll add the numbers and take care of the rest.
Now, if you like,
well, if you're the original
tag as is, great. Don't worry about it. You don't have to do a thing and nothing changes. You'll continue to be you. No suffix will be added. If anyone else wants to use the same gamertag as you, people will always know you are the original.
Okay, cool.
For example, if I see a Major Nelson 345, it's not him.
Not me.
Uh-uh.
Now, if you see Major Nelson followed by numbers, that is not me. But if you see Major Nelson, Wipe a Squad in Apex, that's this guy.
You can't take It's going to take all the wins here. Right, with this new update, your first change is absolutely free. And if you like your gamer tag the way it is, you don't have to change anything. Think of it like, you know, how account names work on like Steam and Discord or Battle.net.
Yeah, it's pretty much exactly the same. Everyone has it this way. Now, you probably have some questions, which is fine. For all the details about when the updates are rolling out, be sure to head over to Xbox Wire at news.xbox.com or hit me up on Twitter at Major Nelson.
Back in February, we took you inside Typhoon Studios, a new studio founded by a group of industry veterans that decided to take the bold, exciting, and scary step to branch out on their own.
Their first project is the colorful sci-fi adventure game Journey to the Savage Planet, which is set to launch on console in early 2020.
Typhoon promised they would reveal some gameplay, and that day is finally here. We've got an exclusive world premiere trailer, so let's check it out.
Journey to the Savage Planet. That was something they didn't really cover.
In just a few minutes, the newest member of the Xbox Game Studios family will be joining us. That's right, Double Fine's Tim Schafer is coming by with Psychonauts 2.
I'm so excited about the Schafer being brought into the fold. It's great. But first, we've got a world premiere trailer for Code Vein. Fans have been waiting, begging, some might even say thirsty, and enjoying other sucky puns like that for the release date of this vampire action RPG from Bandai Namco. At long last, the wait is over.
It seems everyone, everywhere is thirsty. There is a spring that will cure that thirst. One that weeps tears of blood. That's what they said, anyway.
The red mist showed up a short time after the queen was defeated. And when it did, it trapped everyone and everything inside.
I don't know. As I said, I'm kind of disappointed.
We don't have a lot of hope without you.
Especially with the backwards compatibility, there's a lot.
Revenants need to have blood. Without it, they turn into those creatures we call the Lost.
Code Vein.
There you go, Code Vein, arriving September 27th, and I, for one, can't wait. Now, last year, we announced 7 teams would be joining the Xbox Game Studios family, and this week, another very special one was welcomed into the fold, Double Fine Productions, and I am very honored to be joined by the founder and CEO of Double Fine, Tim Schafer. And I hear you're ready to, you know, work on Excel.
Whatever is needed, you know, we're team players here.
That's good. You're going to fit in really well. Now, since it's kind of your first day on the job as part of Xbox Game Studios, I'm helping out with new hire orientation. Great. So I brought your starting paperwork and a Surface laptop.
Great.
It's actually,
free?
Yeah, I mean, nice. You know, it's really good. Maybe we'll have someone take
place
that
in for here
you.
For a blood sample. And,
it's good. Clippy will call you later on.
I'll fill that in after the interview.
Yeah, it'll be great.
No problem.
As one of the OG independent developers, 19 years that you guys have been putting games together. I have been hoping you can give us a quick history of Double Fine for those who maybe have been under a rock.
Yeah, after I worked at LucasArts for 10 years doing graphic adventures and started Double Fine 2000 to make Psychonauts, our very first game, and it was signed with Microsoft. That's how we started the company, was signing a publishing deal with Microsoft. So it's kind of poetic that it's coming around. So the second Microsoft thing we're doing is Psychonauts 2.
So as I first found out about this deal, I was thinking about your past library, and stacking is one of my favorite games. Mm-hmm. I love Costume Quest. My kid is playing Gang Beasts. There's people who, Psychonauts is one of their favorite games, or Brutal Legend, and I feel like if there's a theme to Double Fine's games, it's that there is no theme. So, I was just wondering, like, what's exciting you guys right now in the industry, and you know, where do you think you'd want to take things?
Well, I think the unifying theme across all those is inspiration. Like, whatever we get inspired by is what we pursue. And we've been very fortunate to be able to do that. And joining Xbox Game Studios means we'll be able to do that in a much more, to even a greater extent. You know, just following ideas instead of worrying about deals or chasing any sort of trends or anything like that. We can just think about what makes us really charged up inside. And think about a game like Stacking. That's a very unusual like game about Russian dolls.
You don't see that too often.
Yeah, Lee Petty just thought this would be a cool idea, and we prototyped it. We loved it, and now he's following. You know, he did Headlander and Rad.
Rad, coming out this year.
Coming out this year, August 20th. Huh? And that's our main thing. Is that I think the most important thing is inspiring creative ideas and following those through.
That's cool. So let's talk about Psychonauts 2. People are very excited to see more of it. The game was announced back in 2015. So what's it been like returning to this beloved title?
It's really fun because the characters are really alive in my head all the time. You finish a game, you walk away, but you kind of think about them a lot because you spend so much time in their voices. And there were these story elements that we hinted at in the first game about Raz, who is a psychic and an acrobat. His family's all cursed to die in water, and we don't really go into why that was. And in the second game, we get to actually pick that up and explore his family history and explore why his family was cursed to die in water and how that fits into the larger plot of the Psychonauts themselves, the whole organization. So it's bringing a lot of story elements.
I guess I need to finish Watch Dogs 1. I don't even know where I'm at in the game.
So there was a VR game called Rhombus of Ruin, which, you know, there's some canon information in here, and Psychonauts 2 picks up from that. So did you include any elements from Rhombus of Ruin's gameplay into Psychonauts 2, which is a very different type of game?
Yeah, the story flows from Psychonauts 1, where at the end, the head of the Psychonauts, Truman Zenodo, was kidnapped, and then Rhombus of Ruin, you go and rescue him. But it was meant to be just almost like a backstory for the second game, which is once you've rescued the head of the Psychonauts, he still is acting funny, and you find out there's a mole in the Psychonauts, and you find out that someone is trying to bring an old psychic villain back to life. And there's a lot of this, finding out that this organization, the Psychonauts, international spy organization that uses psychic powers to do powerful works of spy work, is in trouble. And Raz, who has tried to be a member of this organization all his life, now has to help them survive.
Okay, and it's his first day on the job. He's got a new suit. So what can you tell us about what's working as a Psychonaut like?
Well, you work inside, your office is actually inside people's minds. So Raz can astrally project himself into someone else's consciousness and then see their literal demons and monsters and fight them like they're real things. And so they can also create spaces inside other people's minds to trick them into revealing information because they are spies. So in this case, in this demo that we're showing at E3, the Psychonauts have implanted this office space that looks very sterile to trick one of the employees, or one of the, actually Dr. Lovato, who's the villain in the first game, into revealing who hired him to kidnap Truman Zenodo. And so they create this mental space of an office, and then it starts to fall apart, and because Dr. Lovato's a dentist, it starts to get really dental very quick, and a lot of teeth show up, and
Like you do.
Yeah, and hopefully you're not afraid of the dentist, because this level will give you nightmares.
I've been putting that off for some time, but we have great dental here at Microsoft, you don't need to do that.
Just got to fill out that form.
Any new psychic moves players are going to get to use?
Yeah, well, in this demo, we're bringing back a lot of the original psychic powers, like telekinesis, pyrokinesis, and Psy Blast. The game will have, eventually, more new powers, but for the old powers that you might be familiar with, we've enhanced them all and made them work better with each other so you can use them in combat very freely. There's combat as you...
My God, two human is trending. Holy shit.
Away a weapon with telekinesis and throwing it back at another enemy and using Psy Blast on someone who's flying and then burning some other enemies. And so they switch back and forth and combo with each other in interesting ways.
So as we're waiting now for Psychonauts 2, please dig back into the Double Fine catalog. You'll have Rad later this summer, but there's so much to play. You're going to find a favorite game, and it's no two all
alike. Love it!
I'm glad you're on the team. Thank you so much for coming by, and I'll see you at the company picnic.
Awesome. Thanks for your company picnic.
So yesterday's show was a Halo Infinite trailer that resurrected Master Chief and brought so many questions. Right now, Graham is with someone that might just be able to answer them.
Right, so many questions, but luckily Chris Lee from P43 is here to take us through the Halo Infinite trailer and provide a director's commentary of sorts. So Chris, how are you doing first of all?
I'm doing
big
great.
Day yesterday.
So excited to be here at E3 and here on Inside Xbox today.
Pleasure to have you here. So we're going to talk through the trailer. Let's roll up here. Tell us, you know, what should we be looking for in the Halo Infinite trailer from yesterday?
Yeah, one thing that I think is really cool that I see people online that are kind of asking questions about is that was the briefing was the opening sequence for our campaign with Master Chief.
Right.
So that's in our new Slipspace engine, the opening sequence for the game, kind of launching the story of Master Chief.
Okay.
Wow. Awesome. Two human is trending. What the fuck?
This mysterious pilot. Can you tell us more?
What the clock?
Yeah, we're not talking a lot about the pilot at E3 this year, but he is a new character to the Halo universe, and we're really taking our time to introduce the pilot and bring him in for players in a really careful way where you get to learn about the pilot and emotionally connect with them throughout this piece. You'll be seeing the pilot more in Halo Infinite.
And tell us about that moment. It's like a really iconic moment where he wipes the screen and Master Chief's floating out there.
Yeah.
Give us some more context about what's going on there.
Yeah,
Two Human 2 confirmed. Scarlet launch title.
At his lowest.
That would be hilarious.
Watching the hologram, kind of saying goodbye to his family, probably thinking that he's breathing his last breaths, he hears this signal and he runs to that window, and then trying to get him on comms, he can't understand why this UNSC friendly isn't responding, wipes the glass, and it's been amazing to see that reveal of Master Chief and how both that was an amazing moment at the show, and how our fans have kind of taken that and put their own creativity into it.
Because I think Microsoft owns the rights to the games.
I want to go back to you saying that was
but
in-game
not the
footage we're seeing.
So, well, they might.
You know, what's the community been asking you, and you know, how do you want to respond to some of that question?
Yeah, so we debuted the Slipspace trailer last year, and we built all of that content inside of the Slipspace engine. This year is really important to us to go back and build the opening sequence of the game, and it was really exciting to be able to share that with our fans all inside the new engine so they can get a feel for the game and how it will kind of unwrap and show Master Chief's the start of his journey in Halo Infinite.
And can you tell us more about the Slipspace engine itself and how that's going to impact Halo Infinite?
Yeah, so the Slipspace engine is really this labor of love for 343. We've invested heavily. It's going to be the foundation of our next 10 years of Halo experiences. And it really brings together the most powerful tool set we've ever had to empower a creative team to iterate and create this great experience with the ambition of Halo Infinite, which we couldn't have achieved or realized in our old technology. And then combines that with the promise of all of these platforms. We're shipping on more platforms than we ever have before in the Xbox One family. We're going to PC at launch for the first time.
Right.
And then, of course, the power of Scarlet. We get to ship in holiday 2020 alongside Scarlet.
Excellent. Now, we're just seeing Master Chief's armor here. And I know the gif I've seen time and time again is when his armor drops down. Talk to us about the design principle, the philosophy. Where you're going with the armor and everything else you'll see in Infinite.
Yeah, the the art direction for Halo Infinite that Nicolas Bouvier, our art director, has really kind of honed in, you can really see the core of that on Master Chief. It's, our art direction is embracing the full legacy of Halo, taking those iconic themes that players know and love, and then bringing them together and evolving them to create something new. So Master Chief is heavily inspired by Halo 3. It has elements of Halo 4 and Halo 5, and even Halo Legends from the extended fiction. We bring that together and create something that's really distinct and new and special for our fans.
And that's being applied to the sound design as well, right? I mean, one of the things I noticed was the shield recharge sound.
Yeah.
It was very reminiscent of Combat Evolved. Is that something you're going after?
Absolutely. Music and sound are so central to the identity of Halo.
Absolutely.
It's really hard to even talk about Halo without hearing the monks when you're talking about it. Marty O'Donnell and Michael Salvatore kind of set that tone and then had this iconic sound design like the shield recharge effect. And we really want to embrace that. And we have brought on board a new music supervisor, Joel Yarger, who is working with Curtis Schweitzer. We charged them with finding this accomplished composer that could take that legacy of Halo music and sound and bring his own creativity and vision. And that is what you got to experience in Discover Hope. We had Curtis compose all of the music for that opening sequence. And we're really excited to share more of their music vision in the future.
Great, I can't wait to hear it. One of the things I personally loved about the trailer was it felt very focused, it felt very emotional. You know, you mentioned the moment earlier where the pilot is watching this hologram of, I assume, his wife, and you can hear his child in the background. What was the thinking behind going that direction with the trailer?
Yeah, we wanted to really embrace this great storytelling legacy in Halo. And we definitely wanted to be about Master Chief. Master Chief is the center of any of our stories, but we wanted to introduce the pilot and really connect the player to them in a deep way. Our associate creative director, Paul Crocker, is also a writer, and Dan Chozich, our narrative experience director, really wrote and brought this whole opening sequence of the game to life. And one of the great storytelling elements that they've woven into it is kind of reconnecting with some of that feeling you got the first time you stepped on a Halo ring, where there's so much to discover and explore, and we're just really leaning back into that sense of mystery and wonder that Halo has always had. So.
We're getting close to wrapping up, I'm afraid, but I'm going to sneak in another question.
Okay, one more.
Tell us about the end of the trailer. It ends on a bit of a cliffhanger. Can you tell us about, I know you're probably not going to be able to tell us what's next, but tell us about the motivation of Master Chief at that point. You know, what happens next?
We're definitely going to leave some of that shrouded in that sense of mystery and wonder, leave the players with some questions, but that was a really important part of the trailer where Master Chief is going into a very Forerunner environment to kind of reconnect.
All right, good to know. All right, and just very quickly, finally, what was it like being in the theater and hearing the fan reaction in the moment?
Oh, it was amazing in the theater. It's at 343, we always really are motivated to build great things for our fans, and we spend a lot of time working on these experiences and this content to bring it to life. It's just so meaningful to be there and hear people and hear the excitement in the room and get to see that firsthand. It's really an honor to be able to be a part of that.
Excellent. Chris, thank you so much. I've got more questions. I'm going to try and fit them in afterwards. Hey, we were talking earlier that there's a really, really amazing blog post on Halo Waypoint. So head over there, read that, and lots more information there. All right, we're almost done here. Oh, went by so quick. So let's send it over to the team for a look at what's still to come.
Yeah.
Inside Xbox may be coming to a close, but our E3 coverage has only just begun. In fact, it continues right as soon as we stop talking.
They're closing down.
I know, but the lights are going to turn off in a minute. Head over to mixer.com/Forza as soon as we're done for the latest Forza monthly stream. You'll get an exclusive look at the Forza Horizon 4 LEGO Speed Champions expansion, and LEGO design lead Chris Stamp will come by.
And earlier in the show, we said that by August, there'll be over 100 games coming to Xbox Game Pass for PC. Not true.
That's wrong.
It's wrong.
That's wrong.
It's today. And most beta markets. markets is today,
right,
so
now,
check that out.
Access to over 100 games. It's unbelievable.
All right, and then when E3 officially kicks off on Tuesday, the Mixer Dome will go online. So go check it out. Mixer at E3 Live has the show's biggest games, Apex Legends tournaments, special guests, giveaways, and so much more. Head over to e3.mixer.com for all of the details.
For our next episode of Inside Xbox, we're heading to one of my favorite places.
Oh, yes.
Cologne,
oh,
Germany.
Yeah.
Gamescom 2019. As promised, we'll have the first ever gameplay of Gears 5 Horde Mode.
And we'll also have Curry Burst, because I can't wait for that. And ticketing for XO19 in swinging London town. Did I do that right, Julia?
No, no one sounds like that yet.
I did it right.
Not true. Not true.
We're going to be opening up those tickets very soon. You can find out more on news.xbox.com, Xbox's Twitter, at Major Nelson, he's right here,
hey.
And Ravens, because they also have those in England. I've seen it on TV. So thank you so much for watching.
Thank you for watching.
Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you for watching. See you next time.
Make it.
Is it possible that the past and future are colliding?
Rated M for mature.
All right, so that was a good 2 hours of them explaining more stuff that going in a little more depth that they couldn't do in the conference, obviously, but still feel like it, the backwards compatibility, especially with it being the last one, blah blah blah, kind of hurt. Especially with the games they missed that shouldn't have any licensing issues off the top of my head that I know about. Now I'm going in here to look for two human. Nothing really announced for Play Anywhere though. I guess they figure that they're just going to put everything into, whatchamacallit, Game Pass. Everybody's going to just go to the big Game Pass, and that'll be it, and everybody will be happy, for the most part. Oops, wrong one. It's currently not available yet. God. You know, this was basically Destiny before Destiny, except Wow. It's just for single player. Hey, but I can download my horse. God, sorry. Let's see if they've added all these games to backwards compatibility. I just want to see the list. Alright. So we're really looking at a lot of... So I need food. They only include first Blazing Angels. I'm wondering why they didn't include Blazing Angels too. Alright. So I'm not sure if I'm gonna be awake enough to stream the other one. You know what's been missing from everything I've seen is this Command and Conquer. I was really surprised that we haven't seen anything from EA about the Command and Conquer. I know there was a couple articles last month about it, but nothing major. Sorry, I need some food. Just looking through here, seeing if there's anything else amazing. Interesting. If you notice, I have quite a few backwards compatibility games installed. I got an 8 gigabyte hard drive on my Xbox One, so yes, I am ready and willing and hoping for more digital content. So, I don't know. Damn it. I still need to play that. Fuck. Cameo, it's a rare game, so I don't know why it doesn't say owned. Midnight Club Los Angeles. This is 3, isn't it? Does this include the dub edition? Wow, it had multiplayer. I didn't know it had multiplayer. Puzzle quests. First Rage. Which I just recently played. The entire Saints Row series. Silent Hill. I mean, they have almost all the Sonic games. Oh, they do have blinks. I didn't know that. Can I tell you how much I've looked down here? I feel like they're missing so many games down here. So they're going to end up with 37 games for Xbox One. Or Xbox, the OG Xbox. Alright, I am going to go find something to eat. I will be back. Maybe. I might just be playing, rolling around in a little bit of Borderlands before going to bed. See you then.